Good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting in 2015 of the Health and Sport Committee. As I do usually at this point, I would ask everyone in the room to switch off mobile phones as they can often interfere with the sound system. You also note, though, that some of the committee members are using tablet devices, and this is instead of the copies, the hard copies of our papers. I have a small apologies this morning from Dennis Robertson and Richard Simpson, who are unable to be with us, and I welcome Graeme Day as the SNP substitute to the meeting this morning. As usual, with affirmative instruments, we will have an evidence-taking session with the Cabinet Secretary and our officials on the incident, and once we have had all of our questions answered, we will have a formal debate on the motion. First, we're going to look at two of the instruments, the General Medical Council Fitness to Practise and Overarching Objectives, and the Professional Standards Authority for Health and Social Care References to Court Order 2015. The Health and Care Associated Professionals Knowledge of English Order 2015. Can I welcome the Minister for Public Health and the Cabinet Secretary for Health, Shona Robison, Jason Birch, Head of Regulatory Unit, Chief Nursing Officer, Directorate, Ailsa Garland, Principal Legal Officer of the Scottish Government. Welcome to you all. I give the Cabinet Secretary an opportunity to make an opening statement.
Thanks, Convener. Apologies for lateness. I had some travel challenges this morning. The Scottish Government and the health departments in the three other nations are committed to legislative change in healthcare regulation to enhance public protection, and that's why we're seeking to make changes in priority areas agreed in discussion with the UK regulatory bodies through these two orders made under the Health Act 1999. Each order makes amendments to existing legislation regulating health professionals. I want to begin by speaking first in relation to the General Medical Council order. Reform of the General Medical Council's adjudication function has been a long-term UK policy objective, and it was agreed that the Medical Practitioners Tribunal Service should be established. This order will therefore amend the Medical Act 1983 to make that tribunal a statutory committee of the GMC, specifying its powers, responsibilities and duties and modernising its adjudication function. The order will address patient safety issues, including strengthening the power of the GMC registrar to require the disclosure of information from a doctor in the context of investigating allegations, and in the event of non-compliance, to refer a doctor to the Medical Practitioners Tribunal Service for decisions as to whether to impose conditions in relation to registration or suspend that doctor's registration. The order will bolster the objectives of the regulator in relation to its fitness to practice functions to expressly take account of the need to maintain public confidence in the profession and the need to uphold standards in addition to protecting public health and safety. It will also amend the grounds on which the Professional Standards Authority can refer a fitness to practice panel decision to the relevant court and introduces a corresponding new right of reference for the GMC. I want to turn now to the knowledge of English order. The Scottish Government and the health departments in the three other nations recognise that overseas healthcare professionals make a valuable contribution to the NHS, and we're keen to ensure that highly skilled professionals do not face unnecessary barriers to working. However, it is vital that all healthcare professionals practising in the UK have the necessary language skills in English in order to properly communicate with and care for patients. This order will affect healthcare professionals coming to work in the UK from within the EU, and following work with the Nursing and Midwifery Council, the General Dental Council and the General Pharmaceutical Council and the Pharmaceutical Society of Northern Ireland, a system of language controls for EU nurses, midwives, dentists, dental care professionals, pharmacists and pharmacy technicians has been identified to provide greater patient safety. This order gives those regulatory bodies the appropriate powers to apply proportionate language controls so that only those healthcare professionals who have the necessary knowledge of the English language are able to practice in the UK which will sit with existing requirements to provide assurance that they can do their jobs in a safe and competent manner. It will strengthen the regulatory body powers in relation to proportionate language controls and require applicants to provide evidence of their knowledge of the English language following recognition of their professional qualification, but before registration and admission onto the register. The order will also make corresponding amendments to the fitness to practice powers of the Nursing and Midwifery Council, General Dental Council, General Pharmaceutical Council and the Pharmaceutical Society of Northern Ireland so that they can take fitness to practice proceedings in cases where a healthcare professional's knowledge of the English language affects their fitness to practice. Therefore, a new category of impairment relating to English language capability will be created, which will allow the regulatory body to request a professional undertakes an assessment of their knowledge of the English language during a fitness to practice investigation where concerns have been raised. These changes will strengthen the regulatory body's ability to take fitness to practice action where concerns about language competence are identified in relation to healthcare professionals already practicing in the UK. The order is compliant with EU law, which clarifies under recent changes to the Directive on Mutual Recognition of Professional Qualifications, the ability of national authorities to carry out language controls on European applicants in order to establish that those benefiting from recognition of qualifications have a knowledge of language that is necessary to practice a profession. Any language controls must be fair and proportionate. For example, there cannot be automatic testing for all European applicants, and any controls take place after the applicant's qualification has been recognised by the regulatory body, but before registration. Convener, I'm happy at this stage to answer any questions that members may have.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Do we have any members who have a number? Graeme Day, followed by Rhoda Grant.
You can be on. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Can I just ask you how in practice this will work? A very practical level, how will it actually be delivered? And also, who will determine the standard of English and thereby what's proportionate?
Yeah. Well, it will be the bodies themselves will produce guidance that will set out in some detail that what's required. Ailsa, do you want to say a little bit more detail around that?
Yes, that's the Cabinet Secretary's correct, and the various regulators are under duty to publish guidance about exactly what the assessments would involve, and prior to registration of new professionals seeking first registration.
And how will we ensure there's a consistency across all of these bodies?
Well, what we would expect is that the guidance will be quite similar across the regulated bodies, and they're going to be working together in the production of that guidance.
Okay.
So we would see a continuity across those regulatory bodies.
Okay. Just to tease that one out further, and have you had sight of the guidance? Are you involved in talks with the guidance? Oh. What are the important principles that the Scottish Government would wish to see in a set of guidance made available for implementation?
Well, as I understand, I think the guidance is being developed at the moment. Is that right?
I think that's sorry.
Jason, yes. Do you want to say a little bit more about the detail?
Yeah, the regulators are currently in the progress of developing the guidance, and it'll cover key points such as listening, reading, writing and speaking. There's various testing levels which they can utilise, so I think they're part and parcel of working on those bits of guidance at the moment, and we'll get more details further in the year, I think.
But we will have sight of them at an early stage.
The other question is, how do we address that from a Scottish perspective? You know, are there any important principles that the Scottish Government wish to see expressed in the subsequent guidance? Is there a bottom line, or is there a few ideas from the Scottish Government what such a guideline would contain?
Yeah, I think, as I said in my opening remarks, it's about proportionate and fairness. I mean, the standard of I think we would want the guidance to set a benchmark that is proportionate and fair, that is a standard of English that's required for professionals to practice, but it's not onerous in that it sets a bar that's difficult for applicants to reach. I think what the regulatory bodies don't want that either. I think they want a standard that gives them satisfaction and reassurance that the person is able to do their job properly. And
who will take the lead on the development? Who's taking the lead on the development?
The regulatory bodies themselves.
So you're quite content for them to do that?
Well, we'll see that, obviously. We'll see the guidance. And they have the knowledge of the profession and the English standard that would be applicable across their profession. So I think they are definitely the right people to do it. But we would want continuity across those regulatory bodies and the guidance that they produce, and we would obviously want early sight of that.
Rhoda Grant.
We had some evidence from the BMA and also from the Medical Defence Union about the instrument. BMA may seem quite concerned that the chair of the tribunal would be more likely to be legally qualified than a doctor, and they were concerned the way this was set up might maybe not disqualify doctors from taking that position, but certainly make it more difficult, in that it was only if the chair was legally qualified would they become the case officer. I wondered if the Cabinet Secretary could give us her views on that.
The MPTS's discretion, it doesn't have to appoint a legal assessor, only in the circumstances where the chair isn't legally qualified. There's various intricacies in that, which the Department of Health have been leading on. I mean, ultimately, in terms of the GMC legislation, it's in a reserved area, and the Department of Health have been taking the lead on these specific points. So I'm quite happy to raise that point directly with them, if that would help.
That would be helpful, but it would also be helpful to get more of an idea here, because I understand we're going to vote on this instrument. I don't know if we can delay until you're able to provide that clarification.
Can you just clarify the point once more?
The point made is that where the tribunal chair is not as legally qualified, they can be the case officer. That suggests to me that if it's a doctor that is the chair, they cannot be the case officer, which then may be a barrier to a doctor being the chair of the tribunal, because you would then need two people rather than one person.
I think the MPTS has the discretion to look into what is appropriate in the circumstances of that particular case. So I think in the circumstances that you described, if it wasn't appropriate for the doctor to be the chair, if it needed to be a legally qualified person, then they ensure that that was that was the case. Does that help with your query?
Not really. It would be really useful to know what would be done to stop a barrier being created for doctors becoming the chair of the tribunal.
I think there would be no barrier for that to happen. But it would be really a case of the tribunal to look into the circumstances to make sure that the right person had legal qualifications within that tribunal. So I think it's quite open for them to have a legal assessor within the tribunal that isn't the chair of it. But I think the rules will enable a certain amount of flexibility to ensure that doctors aren't prevented from being chair of the tribunal.
Do you know if any guidance will be issued to that effect?
Yes, I think there will be definitely guidance issued on the point, because the particular concerns you've raised have been analysed in the consultation response, and it's something that GMC will take forward in the future.
I mean, we can certainly say that it was raised at committee this morning as a point that needs to be clarified strongly in guidance. We can feed that back. I mean, I don't think it's a material issue to this, but I think it's an important point, and we'll make sure that that's picked up in the guidance through feedback.
Okay, thank you. Can I ask another question?
Yes.
The BMA were also concerned about how decisions were advised to people, and it was kind of saying that the decisions would be given by email rather than by letter. And they were obviously concerned that people may not be reading all their emails and that it should be out by letter. I suppose I'm keener that we communicate electronically, but I wonder what steps would be taken to make sure they received it. Will there be read receipts, delivery receipts and the like? And what happens if those aren't received? Will there be a system to monitor whether or not somebody has received and indeed read the decisions? And if they haven't, is there a fallback position where people will be written to?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's important that they obviously have the most efficient system, which is so why they, I think they've prioritised electronic delivery. But yeah, there will be, as I understand, there would be a receipt system there, and if in the very rare occasions where email isn't available, presumably that would be by letter. But
yeah, the order actually makes provision for the decision to be sent either by post or by email where that's been requested to be sent. Yeah. And there is actually specific provision to say that it's only affected when they get an electronic receipt showing that the email's been opened. Mm-hmm. So it should have been prearranged how they're going to receive the decision, and they have to have evidence of it having been received as well.
Yeah. Bob Doris.
Thanks, Convener. Just follow up briefly on some of the comments Rhoda was making. Mr Birch, I thought it was reasonable in relation to making sure there's no inadvertent barriers in relation to a medical professional being chair of a tribunal. But to clarify, you said that there could be discretion, so it wouldn't be an automatic, they couldn't be the chair, and discretion could be shown in relation to that, and that would be teased out in guidance. It's just, I mean, I don't, it's not a barrier for me in approving this SI, but I think it's just important to get this clear on the official record today in relation to that. So there will be a degree of discretion. It won't be by default they can't be chair. There will be a discretion there.
Discretion and rules will be made on that point by the GMC.
And that will be fleshed out further in guidance.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Right, okay, that's important for me. So it's not a deal breaker for me, but it's important that we get that on the record when we are raising concerns that other people have raised. Okay. In relation to a competence level in English for registration, I'm just reading from the notes that we were provided for in preparation today. And I'll just read from it direct. It says the relevant regulatory body would set out in advance the criteria as to what evidence would be appropriate to demonstrate an acceptable level of English language knowledge. And the important thing for me is the criteria must be flexible. I suppose if I was to raise any concerns, it would be that we had a uniform pass-fail barrier for people in terms of standards of English, because that wouldn't just catch other EU nationals. It should quite rightly catch UK residents long term. So I think what I'm trying to tease out here is that it wouldn't just be a straightforward sit a test to say you have a relevant standard of English, but the regulatory bodies will think very carefully about the proficiency levels that will be needed to perform each particular role. So it's just to kind of get that confirmed. But also to confirm that we are still seeking to encourage other EU nationals and others to work in our National Health Service and beyond, because they're vital to our National Health Service. So I welcome the fact that, and just if you could just confirm this would be helpful, that it will be made clear that they have the relevant qualifications irrespective of whether they then get registration at that point. So there's no qualification barrier, so if you're able to confirm that. But the other question would be, will any advice be given for individuals that maybe don't have English proficiency but may wish to get to that particular standard to allow them to apply at a future date? What would the government view in relation to being supportive to allow people to take further steps to get to the level that would allow registration?
Okay. I mean, I think just in general terms, I'll ask Jason to come in on some of the detail. We don't want unnecessary barriers, and that's why the words fairness and proportionate are used in the opening remarks. I mean, the issue is that the effect of the order changes the point so that the EU professional will still be entitled to be registered, but only after their qualification has been recognised and they can demonstrate the necessary knowledge of the English language. So this isn't a question about their qualification, it's about the English language. In terms of the guidance that the regulatory bodies will set out, I mean, I think they're all looking towards the international English language testing system as a bit of a continuity of approach. And that is a test of all four language skills. So it looks at listening, reading, writing and speaking. And the academic version of that test is widely accepted by employers as a good standard. So the guidance that they will develop will probably centre around that testing system, as I understand. Jason, do you want
to? They don't have to stick to that, but that's seen as a good standard. Mm-hmm. And I think the really important point is that there can't be blanket testing. No. It's only when there's concerns of language ability that crop up. Yeah. And there's a definite separation between recognition of qualifications, compliant with the EU directive, and then ability to actually get on the register and practice. Mm-hmm. Thank you,
Okay. Graham D, I think you want another question.
Thank you. Can I just be clear, Cabinet Secretary? I think I picked up from your opening remarks that assessments could be deployed retrospectively for people already in post. Is that correct?
Concerns are raised, right. Yes.
So can I just tease that out a little bit? What would the processes, what do you envisage would be the processes for raising concerns? Who could raise concerns, and what filters would be in place to perhaps filter out malicious complaints so that they didn't escalate to the point where somebody was being put through an assessment unnecessarily?
Jason, do you want to say something?
Yes. So it will be fitness to practice ground, and it will be investigated in the same way as any allegation would be normally. So it go through the same checking procedure as it would do if there's any concerns raised about that healthcare professional. And that's one of the key points of the legislation to introduce that new fitness to practice ground.
No more questions? Rhoda Grant.
With a couple more based on the evidence we got from the Medical Defence Union. They were concerned about that the tribunal could refuse to admit evidence. And they were also concerned that the tribunal could award costs. Which they thought was kind of a punitive measure rather than, an investigating measure. I'm wondering on what grounds would they refuse to admit evidence and on what grounds would they allocate costs?
I know there's some concerns being raised about this particular point. I think the logic of the policy is to prevent certain circumstances of fitness practice cases going ahead which are vexation, which aren't likely to succeed. So that's the logic behind the costs being introduced in the proposals.
I understood that the allocation of costs was to the defendant. So if you're being asked to come to a fitness to practice tribunal to defend your own record, you may face having costs allocated to you. So it's almost like a barrier for you to look for justice, I guess, from a better...
Well, of course, I mean, I suppose it's the actual fitness practice case results in that happening. It's a technical issue that was raised in the consultation, and I think again that's something that guidance will be provided by the GMC to cover this particular concern on the area of costs by the GMC in due course.
And what about the refusing to admit evidence? That seems to me, I mean, if you're saying to somebody, we're taking you to a tribunal because of your practice, and we're saying we're not going to admit the evidence you're putting forward in your own defence, and what's more, we can actually allocate costs against you if you defend yourself, it seems to me pretty onerous.
It depends on the certain circumstances of the individual case. And I think the rules at the moment state that something quite similar can happen. So I think that needs to be taken into account. In terms of the evidence, let me just think of Ailsa. Can you come in on the legal side?
Yeah, and that would be normal in any sort of court or other sort of form of tribunal, that sometimes evidence might not be admitted if it was thought to be irrelevant to the particular case. I don't know the actual detail of the particular concerns that you've been raising, but I imagine
it's not very clear in the instrument what basis that evidence could be.
Yeah, I don't think it actually comes from the instrument itself, or not to my knowledge. I don't know whether it's to do with how they're expecting cases to be managed going forward, or whether that's going to be set down in rules. I'm not sure.
I think we need to clarify that point, Mona, to be honest. I mean, I understood, and I might be wrong on this. I understood they already have those powers, but and that's not a diversion from the situation that can happen at the moment. But I think we need to get clarification on that. Okay, we'll write to you on that.
Doris?
Yeah, I think, Cabinet Secretary, you may just have answered that question, but my understanding was any tribunal process, it's for the chair of the tribunal and the tribunal to decide what's admissible and not admissible.
This wouldn't change that particularly, but I think we need to get absolute clarification on that, and we'll do that in short order and drop you a note back as quickly as we can.
Okay, thank you.
Are there any other questions? Nanette Millen.
The Medical Defence Union, actually, Regulation 21, which they're opposed to, basically saying that they don't see a need for the GMC to state an overarching objective in primary legislation, because in practice the panel's tribunal system already does look at, bears in mind the maintenance of public confidence in the profession and the maintaining of proper standards of conduct and behaviour. They do pay proper regard to such objectives already, and enshrining this in primary legislation, they say, could well result in a panel placing an emphasis on this aspect to the detriment of the fundamental responsibility of the panel to ensure a fair and just hearing. What your thoughts are?
There's two elements. There's the overarching objective, which you mentioned, and there's an overriding objective for the panels to consider things that are fair and just. And if there's a conflict between the two, the overriding objective takes precedence, that the rules are fair and just. So that hopefully answers that part of the question. I think in terms of the case law, having public confidence being maintained as part and parcel of the overarching objective is already there, but this really sets it on a statutory footing, so it's clearer. And the intention in due course is to have all the regulators with the same overarching objective, to have much greater consistency.
Mm-hmm. That's helpful, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Bob Doris.
I think the only final thing I would ask, in my reading from the notes in relation to the BMA submission as well, in relation to some of the points that have been raised today, it does appear a lot of this is formalising, putting a statutory footing things that are already happening. But I suppose what I would ask is, because my preference would be to support this today, but what I would like to ask would be, how is there a natural review process of this? So, for example, in 1 year time, in 2 years time, 3 years time, do we review this to make sure it's continuing to do what we want it to do? Where would that sit? I think that's important to maybe raise today at committee.
I think we would do that in the normal course of events anyway, and that we would expect the regulators to, with any changes, to monitor the effectiveness of the new procedures. So yes, and what we could perhaps do is to agree to furnish the committee with the findings of that in a year's time, from the regulators, in terms of any issues that are arising. So we're happy to do that.
I think that would be, that would give me some comfort, yes.
Yeah. I think that possibly could, as part of, I mean, I just want to recap for the benefit of the committee, for those people who have, members of the committee who have asked questions and raised some concerns, that I think, I'm sure I got from the Cabinet Secretary a recognition that the concerns that were raised this morning were not being dismissed. They would be concerns that you would take into the discussions in and around how the guidelines would be implemented. You would seek clarity in some of the questions that have been asked here this morning and return that information to the committee. I think that would be useful, just to, you know, have that on the record, and then we can move to the next stage in terms of the debate and how we proceed with the SSI.
Absolutely, I'll give you that commitment.
Okay, thank you very much. I've not got any other questions. I don't see any other questions from the committee members. We now move then to agenda item number 2, which is the formal debate on the first of the affirmative SSIs, which we have just taken evidence. I'm sure I don't need to, but I will remind committee members and others that the question session is now over. So there isn't any other questions that can be put to the Minister at this point. Officials are not allowed to speak in the debates, as I'm sure they know. Can I now then invite the Minister to move motion S4M 12564, laid out before us and previously discussed?
Formally moved, convener.
Thank you. Do any members wish to contribute to the debate? Rhoda?
I think just to put on record that obviously fitness to practice is really important, and is, you know, there is no move against this SSI at all. The concern I think expressed earlier was about making sure it was fit for purpose and worked well. And given the reassurances of the Cabinet Secretary, I think we could work to make it work and indeed meet some of the concerns that have been expressed to us today.
Members, can I ask the Minister to sum up and respond to the debate, please?
Just to really reassure Rhoda Grant that absolutely the points that have been made, we'll feed back and we'll come back to the committee on the couple of specific issues that were raised, and indeed in a year's time or the appropriate moment around the analysis and review of the operation of these new processes and procedures, we would be keen to come back to the committee with an update. So just put that on record.
Okay, thank you. That concludes the debate on that question. And can I, it remains for me now to put the question that motion S4/12564 be approved. Are we all approved? Agreed? Thank you. That is approved then. We now go to agenda item number 3, which is a formal debate on the second of the affirmative SSIs, with pointing out what I've already pointed out in terms of who can speak and who can't, that we are in a debate. Can I invite any member who wishes to contribute to the debate? No, I should invite the Cabinet Secretary to move the motion for me.
Formally moved.
Thank you. Can we... Nanette Millen wishes to take part in the debate.
Just to say that I do welcome this, because I think it's crucially important that communication between professionals and patients is clearly understood on both sides, and I think this will help in situations where there are currently problems. So I support this.
Any other members wish to take part in the debate? No? Okay. Cabinet Secretary, what's your sum up? Respond.
I think just to say that I agree with Annette Millen. I think this will enhance the arrangements and the guidance that we talked about earlier on. I'll make sure that we keep the committee updated as that guidance is developed by the regulatory bodies.
Okay, thank you. And I put the question that motion S4M/12563 be approved. Are we all agreed? Thank you. We now move to agenda item number 4, which is to take evidence on our final affirmative instrument of the day, Community Care, Personal Care and Nursing Care Scotland Amendment Regulations 2015 draft. The Cabinet Secretary will remain with us, but we are about to be joined by Mike Liddell, Team Leader, Reshaping Care Integration and Reshaping Care Division, and Ruth Lunny, Principal Legal Office of the Scottish Government. Can I invite a brief statement from the Cabinet Secretary at this point?
Be very brief, Convener. The draft affirmative order before the committee today reflects the Scottish Government's commitment to increase free personal and nursing care payments in line with inflation. The order, if approved, will continue to benefit vulnerable older people. Last year, we increased the personal and nursing care payments for residents and care homes in line with inflation. The regulations will further increase in line with inflation. The weekly payments for personal care by £2 to £171 per week will increase the additional nursing care payments by £1 to £78 per week. In line with our partnership arrangements with local government, councils will meet the cost of the inflationary increases totalling around £1.5 million in 2015-16. An additional amount of £1.5 million annually was added to the funding for local authorities in October 2012 to cover these additional costs in the current spending review period up to 2015-16. The free personal and nursing care policy continues to command strong support, and I hope that the draft order can receive the committee's support. I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you. Are there any questions for the Cabinet Secretary? I don't see any questions. I'll therefore move to agenda item number 5, which is a formal debate on the affirmative SSI, and which we've just taken evidence. Can I invite the Minister to move motion S4M-12562, please?
Formally moved.
Thank you. Can I offer members the opportunity to take part in the debate? As I'm required to do? No, there's no members wish to take part in the debate. I presume then that there's no wish for the Cabinet Secretary to make any further comments? No? Then we'll put the, it remains for me then to put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S4M-12562 be approved. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. That concludes today's consideration of subordinate legislation. Cabinet Secretary officials for their attendance, and I'm now going to suspend briefly while we set up our panel on evidence. Thank you.
still waiting for Colin.
Oh, is Colin there? Committee now resume our meeting and go to agenda item number 6, which continues last week's initial look at the Commonwealth Games legacy. This morning we have a round table of community sports hubs and local sports organisations. Welcome to you all this morning. As usual, when we have a round table, though, we invite people to introduce themselves before we move to our discussion. So I should start, I suppose. My name is Duncan McNeill, convener of the committee and MSP for Greenock and Inverclyde.
Good morning. Paul Reddish, trustee and volunteer at Inch Park Community Sports Club, which is a sports hub based in Edinburgh.
Bob Doris, MSP for Glasgow and deputy convener of the committee.
That's a loyal MSP for the central region.
Morning. Darren Reid, community sport hub officer for Highlife Island.
Roger Grant, Highlands and Islands MSP.
Good morning, I'm Graham Clay. I'm the Senior Sport Development Officer for North and Lanarkshire Leisure.
Good morning, I'm Colin Keir, Constituency MSP for Edinburgh Western.
The MSP for Highlands and Islands Region.
Morning, my name's David Smith, the Chairperson of Drumchapel Community Sports Hub.
And I'm Fiona Cardwell. I'm the club coach and volunteer sports development officer for Glasgow Sport.
Nanette Milne, MSP for North East Scotland.
Andrew Smith. I'm a sports development and facilities team leader at West Lothian Council.
So you're all on the record now at the committee. You can sit in silence for the rest of it. Our first question, just to get the discussion going, is Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Convener. As the Convener already said, last week we heard from Sports Scotland, Sports Association, selected local authorities. Today I want to hear from the people who are at the coalface. And one of the questions one of the submissions that was made to us was a comment by one of your fellow colleagues, and I'll quote it. I firmly believe that sport is yet to be a permanent feature at the top table of national responsibilities. Until such time, sports continues to fly in the face of this relative adversity. What, in the panel's view, is the adversity to sport, and how do we move sport up to the top table to ensure that sport is given its rightful place to improve the health of our nation?
Andrew, did you want to take... I've seen you bracing yourself there. I'm just
trying to process
it. Right, you, Andrew, you're first to respond then.
I think a major challenge of sport is making the ties between the sport agenda and the health agenda as well. There are definite benefits and there's obvious ties, but at the moment a lot of them seem to be anecdotal rather than actual evidence-based. Taking part in sport, there's a massive amount of benefits that will bring to people and communities. Along with the health benefits and the fitness benefits, there's also the sociability. There's opportunity to meet new people and to kind of break down barriers across communities. But it's been able to make the definite ties between sport and these other different items on the agenda that will allow sport to raise up on the agenda. So,
yeah, happy to.
Yes, Paul. Thanks.
I'll give you a comparison of where I think sport is behind on this and doesn't help itself. And this is, participation is important when it comes to sport. But if you were forming a new medical treatment, you wouldn't measure it by how many people start the treatment. You'd measure it by the results. And, some of the things that Andrew cited there are right, and there's lots of sort of evidence out there. But I guess, when you look at things that are published, when we talk about legacy and impact, a lot of it's around numbers. And I think to start to persuade people that don't work in sport of the benefits of sport, we do need to come a bit more outcomes focused in how we put our case forward around the difference that sport makes. We all see it, those of us that work in it every day, but I don't think from a communications perspective we're so strong at putting the outcomes forward that are wider in terms of the benefits and not just the sporting elements.
Anyone else? David?
A couple of points, really. I believe that there's a reliance on volunteers who are already well overcommitted and well overstretched, and due to their personality, they're wanting to make a contribution and feel that what they've got to offer would be beneficial. However, there's not enough people to be able to participate. Another issue for me would be, certainly in Drumchapel, funding is ring-fenced. So for our community sports hub, there was a budget that came along with it, but the money is to be spent on certain issues. Now, it's already been mentioned about wanting to hear from the people at the Coal Face, which is great, and thank you very much for the invitation to come along and speak here today. But who better to know what money should be spent on in some of our communities than the people who live there, the people who operate there? So to receive a budget in order to benefit sport is fantastic. But walking around my community, the issue is it may be issue A, and it's important to the people in that community. However, when you come back to your community sports hub meeting, the money can only be spent on issue B, C and D. So you're walking around, you think you can make a difference on issue A, but the tools that you've got to do the job don't fit. So that's an issue. And for me, probably as well, the number one issue would be the kind of postcode lottery of access to sport. So the community where I live, just to kind of give you some idea of the issue, would be it's £35.50 to hire an astrograss pitch or a pitch for under-16s. Now, neighbouring authorities that border Glasgow, most of them give access to facilities for under-16s for free. The other local authorities, for instance, Western Bartonshire Council, for a facility of the same nature is £13 an hour. So the barriers that we face straight away when we identify an issue, get people involved in sport, increase participation, Commonwealth Games legacy, all the kind of buzzwords. The number one issue we meet every time we go to organise an event, congregate people together to consult their views is, oh, wait a minute, we need to pay all that money for use of the facility. Okay, why don't we go to a neighbouring authority and hire the facility? Well, that takes away the point of doing it in your own community. So for me, those are three of the major issues, certainly, that which we face in Drumchapel and Glasgow. Thank you.
Number of issues there. Anyone want to take up some of those issues? I mean, barriers, the strategy, we just give the money down to the communities. We don't, you know. I was trying to elicit some, you know, put you down in the sheet for it to speak.
Oh, no,
I was trying to elicit some panellists in there to see if we can get a discussion in it. Sorry, Bob. Yes, Darren.
I think just David touched upon this the first point there about the opportunities we have with community sport hubs is to have that very much community-led approach. And where we find real success in the Highlands is being able to investigate that local sporting infrastructure from the bottom down, so very much being around who's involved in sport within the local community, where does sport happen within the local community, and more of that conversation is about, are all these people talking to each other? There's a lot of people involved in sports, both professionally and in the volunteer level, but the community sport hubs have really given us the opportunity to nail down actually who's doing what within the local communities, where it happens, and what is the needs of the local clubs. You mentioned about the volunteering base. I think one of their key objectives of the community sport hubs in the Highlands is about that people. So how do we help and support the people that are on the ground making sport happen to make it slightly easier for what they do? And I think if the community sport hubs are going to be a success, it has to be community-led. It has to be driven by the people that's on the ground making sport happen within our local communities.
Andrew?
In West Lothian Council, we've used the hub as a vehicle to bring together services in that local community as well to be able to tackle a number of inequality issues. So it's being led, you know, by sport. Let's get, you know, adults and young and children and young people to facilities to play sport through clubs. But it's also to look at the health benefits of that and joining those kids and the schools in those communities to the health services that are there. So we've really used that to kind of, you know, to as a vehicle to drive that all happening in a local community. Within the hub as well, we've got a forum for the clubs, and local people can come and sit and tell us their issues. And a large part of those issues were funding, and were funding and around the pricing structure of sports halls and things around West Lothian. So we've used the hub to be able to tackle that and look at pricing structures across hubs as we then start to roll them out across the county as well. Within that club forum, that then feeds into a strategic steering group that's led by the head teacher of the school, it's led by local councillors, and allows them to kind of understand the issues that the local people are facing with regards to kind of health and sport. So hope that can answer your questions there.
Do those tensions still exist? Because when we took evidence, what was that, nearly 18 months ago, you know, in community sports and access to community resources, we had that tension between local clubs who don't see themselves as part of that sport hub, would say to David, don't bother paying professionals to deliver sport in the hub or the community centre. I've been doing that for 20 years. If you just give me some of that money, it'll save me getting out and fundraising and I'll be able to spend more time coaching. That would be a community objective. We've heard some of that in evidence here, that a lot of the money was going into certain sporting activities and legacy activities in Glasgow and beyond wasn't going into the sport clubs. It was going into to establish other means of delivering sport when there were hundreds of volunteers delivering that sport who needed urgent help with fundraising. How have we managed that, and how have we reduced that tension and better working relationships with existing social sports clubs and the new sport hubs that have been built up, mainly in and around our educational facilities, our community supported facilities. Graham, I think, and Paul, yeah, and Darren and Andrew all want to respond to that. David, you want to come back? Not at this point, but, you know, I'll let you in if you do.
I would very much say that within North Lanarkshire, the main vehicle for the utilisation of the Community Sport Hub budget has been to develop those types of organisations that you're referring to in terms of our sports clubs with a history of delivering within that community. Very little of the Sport Hub budget within North Lanarkshire has been used to deliver new activities that have had a short-term focus. It's all very much been long-term volunteer development projects in order to ensure that we are empowering that local community to deliver what's needed. I think, sorry, just slightly coming back to that friction or that kind of clash of supporting the clubs and then the kind of outcomes of perhaps facility managers is where we see that friction, because we've got a clash of objectives in terms of people operating facilities obviously have to meet their income generation targets in terms of letting that facility, so it may be of benefit to them to not have a community organisation in there, and they may want a commercial organisation in there who are paying a higher let cost. So that's where that priority of sports development and facility development can clash.
Okay. Paul, you wanted in, I think, Dan as well, and Andrew, right?
I guess, you know, I'm not from the local authority, I'm a community-based sports hub, but, you know, one of our team does sit around the table in Edinburgh around the discussions, and what I would say is that there's still some work to do on that, but it has got better, and I'll explain exactly why. I think when the community sports hub strategy started out and we started looking particularly at school-based models and things like that, there was such a drive around a single metric around getting sports involved and getting people involved that it became a bit of a numbers game. And I think a lot of the time it was more of a reporting exercise rather than actually doing any real new or improvement to provision or supporting the clubs in those areas. I think there's been a recognition of that, and I think that's starting to change from what I've seen. But I don't think we're quite there yet in Edinburgh. One slight worry that I have is that we then go and grow too quickly and bring in more sports hubs whilst we've still not addressed that problem, and then we hit the same problem again. So I think, you know, there's a sort of a step back that, you know, I've been lobbying for in Edinburgh that says let's just make sure we get it right before we grow any more sports hubs, rather than starting to do another 6 here and another 8 there and then adding more reporting and more participation numbers, not actually getting into what's going to make a difference in the communities.
Is that what you were meaning earlier when you alluded to numbers here? Don't count it on the number of sports clubs, or don't judge us on just the numbers of participation or the numbers of coaches?
Yeah, I'll give you a manifestation of that that's a prime example. Where, you know, without wanting to be too critical of one or two of the other setups and hubs, you know, one that's been, I guess, put forward as really successful, and Edinburgh has somewhere in the region of 35 clubs and within its hub and, you know, several thousand members. And, you know, we were pushed politely a couple of years ago why we only have three or four clubs. Now, we have quite high standards that we've set around where if you want to be involved in the community, these are the things that you have to deliver. Otherwise, you're just a commercial let, and they're about getting young people involved. They're about going and delivering in the schools. They're about delivering in the community organisations. So I guess rather than collecting clubs, we've sort of set a benchmark and said, this is what being a community sports hub is all about. Yet the reporting that was done 2 years ago, there was no opportunity to talk about that. It was about how many clubs, how many. So I think there's something about the way sort of national reporting has been driven in the past that's driven that behaviour. And as I say, I do think it's started to change, but I don't think we're quite there yet.
Thanks for that. Dan? And then...
Yeah, I think just from a Highlands point of view, and I will touch on the numbers, that fundamentally our community sport hubs are a club development tool. We're going to have, hopefully, by the end of 2015, 60 clubs involved with community sport hubs, catering for 3,600 participants of sport, around 350 volunteers, and fundamentally, our community sport hubs are about supporting this to happen and supporting that club infrastructure to make sure that they're delivering the best that they can deliver, and trying to reach that world-class sporting system within every one of their communities. Also, just to touch upon, that understanding of the local need. So the community sport hub for us have been an opportunity to come together with local clubs. So if one club is struggling with coach development, with promoting themselves, the club along the road is asking for the same thing. So collectively, it's a lot easier to deliver these things, and especially in a rural context, delivering coaching courses, if we can team up with the school, with the school's volunteers and the club volunteers, we can actually make things happen within our local communities. And just the final point is about the professional input that comes alongside the community sport hubs that have been a real benefit in terms of having that conversations with the head teachers, with the head of PE, with the schools coordinators, with the facility managers, and are touching on youth work. So there is a professional structure within local communities that through the community sport hubs we're starting to have that conversation with how we're best supporting that local sporting structure.
Andrew.
Thank you. First of all, I agree with what Paul said there about the reporting. If you take Armadale Community Sports Hub at the moment, we saw massive growth in the first year and a half. But now we're at a stage where the facilities are maxed out and we're not going to get a lot of additional growth from that one facility. So, you know, the numbers do tell a certain story, but it's a kind of softer evidence that goes behind that, and the actual impact we're having on the clubs and you know, so increase in number of coaches, increase in number of volunteers, the amount of kind of work that the clubs are actually now doing in the schools in the Armadale community that they weren't previously doing. That's the kind of stuff that we in a local authority are looking at and reporting back to our councillors and senior managers. With regards to the sustainability of our project, we set out from day one when we received the money from Sport Scotland to make the hub sustainable. And within that sustainability, it was being able to afford a professional officer in the hub from the income that was generated from the letting. We've been able to achieve that at Armadale. And what that means is for my team in sports development and facilities team is I've now got an extra member of staff that's now based in the community. And we can drive a lot of the provision that we run across the county. We can drive that very locally to the clubs in that sports hub. That officer doesn't work a 9-to-5 job. He works a very flexible kind of work pattern, which allows him to be there at evening and weekends to get to know the clubs, to be able to support them and understand their needs. So that kind of looking at that kind of sustainability with the professional officer side of it. We also have an affiliation package that we'll be rolling out to sports hubs as we move into other school estates across West Lothian. that looks at everything from their accreditation, be it with the governing body or with a local authority accreditation package. It looks at what after-school stuff they're doing. It looks at what curriculum stuff they're doing. And it also looks at what other community things that they're doing. So, for example, a fun day in the community, a fun run, or some other kind of a health promotion thing. Are those clubs active? Are they there? And are they promoting their club and the health benefits that their club could bring to the local community? So and that affiliation package then helps with the letting procedures as well. So again, if we've got two clubs looking at the same space on the same day, and we know one club's just there for adult members and you know they're just there to play the five-side football once a week, compared to a club that is looking to develop young people through volunteering and through the sport, you know, this affiliation package helps us make a good informed decision on who can get that let. So there's a number of benefits that that's brought to us. So.
David, and then I'm going to get one of the committee members to move us on a wee bit. David, go on.
Thanks. Yeah, I believe in Drumchapel there's been a kind of coordinated approach. Glasgow Life have been very supportive of all the clubs in the area, obviously through being chairperson of our group. You form relationships with all the different people who become part of the sports hub. There's a variety of different sports, and you're able to see firsthand the difference having that staff support makes, which is very good. It's pleasing to hear from the other people contributing to the discussion that facilities seem to be good in other areas, and there's different packages available for deciding who's going to get access to which let. But again, bringing it back to Drumchapel, the issue for us was for a long time the facilities were not up to standard. So there was old style astro pitches down gravel parks, which are not very suitable for modern sport. So the issue for us for a long time was definitely facilities. After realising that there wasn't much we could do to improve that, the focus then became on coach education and improving the standard of coaching that volunteers deliver. And that seemed to make a big difference through meeting other people in different sports. You could see the difference that was making. So access to first aid courses or doing child protection courses or progressing through your coaching pathway in whichever sport you belong to through the national governing body all seemed to make a big difference. Now for us, the issue is that the facilities in our community have improved tenfold. There's a new third generation Astro facility being put down. There's better facilities available. Tennis Scotland have made a huge investment in the local tennis courts. The local sports clubs improved from a ramshackle building to almost like a kind of a real top quality facility. Now for us, the issue we're finding is that these local people in these local communities who have been campaigning on these issues for a number of years prior to my involvement in sport in 2007, 2008 when I first got involved in my local community, now seems to be that we have these fantastic facilities and they're the pride of the community. People love being there, having the opportunity just to set foot on those kind of surfaces and do your coaching is everything that you've ever dreamed about as a volunteer. And now the issue is that we're being priced out of using those facilities, you know, and people are travelling from other parts of Glasgow or out with Glasgow using facilities in the local community. Now, I don't have an issue with that. If someone wants to come and use the facility, great. It's populated, it's been used, there's a benefit to other people. But surely the people who live in that community who have been using the horrendous facilities that were there previously should have an opportunity to get onto those type of surfaces, get into those types of indoor buildings, use the new equipment that's been bought for the benefit of the people who live there. And that's certainly not the case now as we sit here today, which is tragic. So this morning on my way here into the train, I've received a number of text messages and phone calls about volunteers at the club I coach at looking at private sector facilities which are cheaper to hire than those in our local community, the Glasgow Life facilities. And for me, that's an absolute travesty. Now, the other issue for us in our community would be the prescriptive nature of support from whichever organisation is supporting you. So for us, it's Glasgow Life, and obviously they've been a tremendous support for a prolonged period of time. But the problem is that the staff who support you also have an agenda, and it's been mentioned at the table as well about, you know, in order to receive our support, you have to do this, you have to do that. Now, we have to remember the nature why people volunteer.
And for me and all the people I've ever met, the reason they volunteer is because they enjoy it. They've maybe participated in the sport as a child, had a fond experience and want to give that back to the community where they live. But also, that's why it's important to them. And the last thing a volunteer wants to hear is someone who's given up their time for free to pass on whatever knowledge, experience or expertise that they've developed. The last thing that type of person wants to hear from somebody who's been paid to sit at that table with them, let's not beat about the bush, is in order for you to receive my support, you have to do this, this and this. So an example of that would be, in order for you to receive my support, you have to go into the school and coach. Wait a minute, I only volunteer with my club because I enjoy this. I don't want to be told that I have to give up more time to go here and coach. Now I have to go there and coach if I want to keep you. So for us, that would be another issue.
Thanks for that, David. There were issues in a very general nature that were reflected in our report about some 18 months ago, the whole question of access and some of these questions that you've explained right down at the ground are still there, obviously. I've got, I think, Mike McKenzie, our first, our next committee question, to see if we can take things on.
I was very struck by Andrew Smith's talk of thus far all we have is an anecdotal connection between sport and participation in sport and health outcomes. And I think that's something you'll recall, Convener, I brought this up at last week's meeting. And I think it's perhaps a challenge for us as a committee to see if there's research beyond anecdotal to make the connection between greater participation in sport and not the health outcomes per se, but the general population changing their lifestyles to the extent that they follow more active lifestyles. So that's something I think we should perhaps as a committee follow up on and perhaps feed back to the folk that have come in to give evidence today, because I think if we establish that connection, then we can perhaps make a better case in the future for funding for these kind of facilities. I'm interested if the witnesses this morning would agree with that. And the other thing, while I've got the microphone, Convener, while I've wrestled the microphone to me, is just the question of funding, because I noticed that David has brought up the method of funding of our sporting facilities. And I wonder, and again, this is a question maybe for the committee to investigate, though, I wonder, and I'm a bit, forgive my ignorance, but I wonder how much, VAT is charged for the use of facilities. I would expect that's something that the UK government should be sympathetic towards, looking at either reducing the VAT or zero rating it. I am aware, and Darren will know, for instance, the Lough Aber Sports Association have got a particular problem with VAT at 20% on the construction costs of a facility there. And it strikes me that we've funded the Commonwealth Games, we're talking about the legacy. That's happened in Scotland. What contribution are the UK government making? And the mechanism for that contribution seems to me to be one whereby we could look at maybe a reduction of VAT. I wonder what witnesses think about that.
Paul?
Cool way to start with that. Okay, a couple of quick things on both outcomes and funding, and then a direct answer on how you can help. The outcomes are there, and Drumchapel are involved in this as well. I know, those of us that are involved in youth work and sport and Robertson Trust and different funding bodies that are involved in sport have benefited from an awful lot of work looking specifically at outcomes. And, there's quite a nice framework now that covers things like links to antisocial behaviour and various other things and the difference between outputs and outcomes and then applying that back to your programmes. So the research is there, and the outcomes that sport can deliver for the community and for society in Scotland who have been well researched and you know, are available. The challenge, I think, is that one, they're not widely known and available to all sports clubs, and two, back to a point that David made around funding and you know, we've already talked about around reporting in some aspects, it's not asked for. So in terms of being able to evidence that in order to release funding for certain things, it is very much about participation and things like that. So there's maybe no incentive, if you like, to be able to bring this to the fore. So in terms of what the committee can think about doing, you know, the research is there, but the question I'd have is, well, how do we get it further out there? And then how do we link that to, you know, the different submissions that are required, as opposed to just the one-dimensional, you know, numbers thing. On the funding and the VAT issue, again, this is more of an expertise thing. It's back to volunteers. You know, there are things that sports clubs can do to in order to give themselves VAT breaks and various other things and claim back gift aid and all sorts of things. The issue is that most sports clubs are run by volunteers, and the treasurer probably has, you know, a working knowledge of Excel, and that's about it. So, you know, the answer you'll probably get to the question, you know, are breaks available to sports clubs, is yes. But if you're fortunate enough to have a club like ours where we've got some expertise to run that, that's great. We can benefit from that. For your general Joe Blog sports club, it's just too complicated and too time-consuming. So the challenge around that one, if you were to look at it, would be how do you make it simple for people with a base level of skill that are doing the treasury accounts to be able to make that work for their sports clubs.
Anyone else? Fiona.
At Glasgow, just to take your point about the sort of financial knowledge from clubs, you're right in what you say, that there's not a lot of expertise at some clubs that are run by volunteers whose primary concern is their community and the development of sport. At Glasgow, we've identified that as an issue. We've currently got 10 clubs on a pilot programme, a sustainability programme in conjunction with Jobs and Business Glasgow. Now, we hope that through running that programme, those 10 clubs will have the skills and the knowledge to move forward in terms of developing the structure of their club to make them financially sustainable. And hopefully they'll get that advice and information that they're looking for in terms of where they can make savings, things that they currently aren't aware of. We are very good as sports development officers of telling clubs where funding is, but perhaps where we fall short as well is telling them about the sustainability of their club and how they can structure it better in terms of managing their income and outgoings.
David?
Hi there. Yeah, just to pick up on the points that were made about the clubs and stuff and funding. Volunteers who run their clubs, it's the people who participate in the clubs who pay the subscription weekly, monthly, annually. And for us in Drumchapel, obviously, that can be a big issue. Now, according to the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation, Drumchapel is ranked very lowly in terms of community. So I've pulled off a couple of stats from the NHS Neighbourhood Profile 2014, which is a different document. Now, 47% of children in our community are still living in poverty, according to this document. 69% of households don't have access to a car or mode of transport. And 45% of the people within our demographic are single-parent households on low incomes. So taking into account our demographic and the fact that members pay subscriptions, well, that's obviously an issue for us. Now, if we bring this back to the facilities being expensive, then that's also another issue. In terms of the points that have been made there, absolutely delighted to hear from Paul about how clubs can claim back gift aid or there's VAT issues. That kind of information should be made readily available to anybody who ever puts their hand up to volunteer in a community sport. And probably I'd just like to finish by saying that if that kind of information is there and it's available to sports clubs to apply for, then why didn't I know about it before now? And in terms of the point that was made by Mike about claiming back VAT and stuff, anything that can be done to make a volunteer's job easily, in my opinion, should be done, because generally a volunteer may have a job, a family.
But cost, yep. And I think we looked, yep, at it as a committee, and, yep, and while it can be a barrier, it's not always a barrier, and we heard, mm-hmm, last week that it doesn't necessarily increase participation. And certainly I live in an area where there is free football, but that doesn't guarantee those who participate get to play free, because it's not necessarily passed on. So maybe you can reflect on some of that and maybe tell us how you would pass that on to ensure that those people you rightly described in need, if there was free football there, would it mean free for those who play on a Saturday or a Sunday or a Wednesday, which is the next challenge, because the clubs still need to raise money and they still, you know, take the same charges as they took, despite the fact of it being free, they're still, you know, taking the same charges from those who are participating, the poor people that are participating. You know, so there are big issues there, but we have really, I think, we've got the message of access in terms of school holidays. Transport can be very difficult, and it's from a committee's point of view, we have got that message. But might raise some other issues. If anybody wants to respond to that now, and if not, then I'm going to move on and take my next question. Andrew, you would like to.
Just a couple of points you made there. You're very right about how onerous running a sports club can be on volunteers. And it's that balance of having professional people in place that can support the clubs to develop and grow. Some of the stuff you touched on about gift aid and things like that, that's open to, we're seeing more and more clubs in our area becoming an incorporated organisation. So before, clubs historically have been constituted and that's it. They've got, apart from their governing body, they've got no one to report to, or they've got no one, they've got no other status. There's a move now for clubs that are more organised to move to a charitable status, be that a full charity, be that a business limited by guarantee, or be that a social charitable incorporated organisation. I'm learning about that just now and I feel I'm a wee bit behind the curve with it, but there's a lot of learning to be done in that area, and there's a lot of benefits that can be brought to clubs. Gift aid is one of them, claiming back VAT and things like that as well. So there's local authorities, I think, for me anyway now, we're getting guys in to give our development officers training to help us understand this move over to incorporated organisations, and it gives the clubs better legal support as well, it takes liability away from committee members as well. Definitely agree with you 100% that there's a massive amount of pressure on volunteers to develop local sport in the communities. And I see it as my job in my local authority to try and take a wee bit of that pressure off the volunteers. I volunteer for a club myself, and I've got a young family and I've got a full-time job and all that, and so I know how precious my time is, and I know that's going to be replicated across my committee and other committees and other clubs. So 100% take that on board. With regards, can I just go back to Paul's statement there, just very briefly, about studies and information being out there with regards to the evidence and the links between health and sport. I think there is evidence there, you're right, with the Robison Trust and other funding bodies as well, but that information is, as you're saying, it's being held within those organisations. There's not enough educational evidence being done at universities that actually look at the links between health inequalities and participation in sport. And I think until there's more of those reports and those studies done, there were ministers and there were politicians will go when they're coming up with policies. They're not going to go to the Robison Trust, they're not going to go to these other places per se. They're going to go to what's on the shelf through journals and things like that as well. So we need more of that, more educational studies based on what are the actual links between sport and health. So that's me finished.
Okay, thanks. I appreciate that. Thank you, mate. I brought some additional stuff out there. Thanks. Rhoda?
We are all keen, and certainly when we're looking to devise policy, we're all keen to get people more active for all the health benefits, not just physical health, but mental health, education, the benefits go on and on. It seems this morning people are kind of almost splitting into two groups. One, you use sports hubs for community development, and then you use the volunteers to do all that. And then there seems to be a bit about how do you allow those clubs to become fun, which keeps people going, which actually does the mental health thing. How do you allow volunteers to volunteer at a way that is suitable for them? To me, I don't think those two things are mutually exclusive. I don't think we should be kind of saying that or that. So I suppose, how do we equip hubs to support both groups? Because obviously we want to go into schools and into communities to encourage people who are not active now to become more active and maybe join clubs that are already there. but how do we also support and keep the volunteers who are maybe doing this for fun, maybe had a child who was interested in a sport, got involved themselves for that reason? How do we keep them on board while trying to, I suppose, grow the whole thing?
Any responses, Paul?
They're getting harder, aren't they, these questions? Thanks. This is not so. For a day job, I run a national volunteering organisation, and this is, you know, the constant challenge we have. We work with charities all the time, and it's the constant unanswered question, which is how do you deliver your strategic objectives when you're relying on a voluntary workforce who are doing it, you know, for the things that they enjoy. Still don't have an answer to that entirely, but I am going to go into sort of one or two things that I think could help on that specifically. I think at a national level, and when you're thinking about it as a committee and you're thinking about sports, community sports hubs, it's the recognition that everyone's different as a starting point, and that there are, you know, so there are models with ones in schools, there are models like mine, which is a wholly owned community asset, there are models around sports clubs, there are models that are based in, you know, deprived communities like Drumchapel, there are models that are based in ones that are a bit more affluent. The reason I'm sort of explaining that is then the needs that are different, the needs of each one will be different. The reasons the volunteers will be volunteering may well be different. When I think about the local cricket club that's nearest to us, Carlton Cricket Club up the road, you know, a lot of the kids that go to that are from independent schools. And, you know, actually their junior section generates a profit. In the way it's £140 just to join, and you get a nice key to the gate and you can walk your dog around the rounds and that sort of thing, and most of the volunteers are parents of the kids. The volunteers that we work with, are working with some real challenges, and they're working with some young people that, you know, if they weren't doing sport, they could... The outcomes that are sort of set out for them are quite difficult. So their social cause can be quite different. Now, what that means, so it's a very long answer to me saying, well, what that means is that if you think about the model at that sports club up the road, the motivations are very different to the one that I'm working because of the community needs. And I think just a recognition that you know, each community and each community sports hub has different needs, and that the volunteers may have different motivations. And then being able to support what that would be a good move forward, as opposed to maybe just looking at each, you know, a community sports hub as a nebulous concept.
Anyone else want to respond to that? Andrew and then David.
I think it's important to... A lot of community sports hubs are based within a school estate. And we've spent a lot of time working on a relationship with the head teacher of the high school and then the head teachers of the subsequent primary school, so working very closely with active schools teams as well. When we're talking about clubs maybe helping with curriculum time activity and after-school activity, it's not necessarily the head coach of that club that's doing the evening stuff, because they generally have full-time jobs. It's looking at other resources that are available to us. So, for example, sports leaders courses, they run in every high school in West Lothian, and it's about looking at can we develop the young people in these courses to support some other sports activities. It's not going to be, you know, your Olympic level kind of sport. It's, as you said, it's sport for fun. So it's getting the kids engaged and getting them to want to choose to take part in that sport more often. So it's looking at what other mechanisms there are locally that can allow that youth participation and that kind of school curriculum time and extracurricular time participation that then can feed into clubs. So,
David.
Thanks. We found in our community that in terms of keeping people involved and making it fun, there seems to be a kind of a two-pronged approach where I'm of the firm belief that whatever people are involved, they're your biggest and best resource. And if you can utilise whatever skills or abilities they bring to the table, then some special things can happen. So it's obviously been made aware that I've been banging the drum this morning about finance, but at the same time I'm sitting here and I'm reflecting about some of the real kind of special people and characters that we've got in our community, and about the things that we've been able to pull off together as a collective through being involved in the Sport Hub. And a couple of events spring to mind that kind of demonstrate this dual-pronged approach, which would be... The Drumwealth Games was something that we've been organising for the past few years, and that's mainly targeting people in primary schools and high schools, and it's about saying to the kids who are involved there, hey, this is all your clubs who are in your local community. Come along, try it, see if you think it's fun. If you do, great. Here's the contact details about how you can join. And that's about targeting new players, new athletes, new performers, and engaging them in a fun experience, which we found has been working really well. The other thing that we do in terms, and this is maybe more about kind of PR and targeting the community, would be an event called Day in the Park. And we get round a lot of the financial aspects with that by we just hold it in our local park and we all turn up with whatever equipment we've got. We plan it, we organise it, we advertise it, and everybody comes along for a day and takes part for free. So there's football, taekwondo, judo, lots of different sports in the middle of that park, and leaflets and flyers and information's handed out. Parents can come and try the sports with their child, whether the child's 2 months or 20 years old. And we found that these two events seem to be working really well, hence we're replicating them every year. So that, in terms of increased involvement and removing barriers, we found that these events are working really well and they're fun. The community engage with it well.
They've beaten the drum for Trump Chapel. That was a good one. That's to be tweeted out later on, that, Dave. Well done. Darren, you want to respond to Rosa's question as well?
And I think the rest of the guys around the table have made some really good points. But just to get back to just Rhoda's question, I think the opportunity through the community sport hubs is all that partners are round the same table. So you have the guys that are social clubs. It's the fun element. You've got that, the schools coordinators that are driving the participation levels through schools. But you've also got the other side of you've got the performance sport. You've got the clubs that are driving athletes to be the best they can be. And I think that's the opportunity through the community sport hubs, that all these people are around the same table, and collectively for our local communities, is we're delivering that quality package of sport and physical activity that caters for every need within the community. And I would like to get our community sports hubs to the stage where, at the moment, yes, we've involved sports clubs and the people that are directly involved in sport, but maybe around that table as well, should we have the NHS, we're starting to get the youth work around the table as well, because all these people have influences on the sport within the local community. And do we hopefully get to that end point where if I'm a person within that local community, there's something for me to keep me healthy and active?
Just similar to what you said yourself there, the two events David spoke about, I can't stress enough the importance of partnership working for both of those events to work. The D60 group is a group that was set up to celebrate Drumchapel's 60th birthday. Around that table is the Forestry Commission. I sit there and represent the Community Sports Hub, and going back and speak to David and the guys involved with that hub. And those events only happen because of those groups coming together. Similar with the Drumwealth Games, active schools play a real key role in the communication side with the schools, helping us understand what events the kids want to do so that we can put on fun activities that they want to take part on. And more importantly, we can follow up because it's delivered by local clubs. So if those kids enjoy it, the very next day they can go and play football or tennis locally. It's not down to a commercial enterprise to deliver that for them, and they're not having to pay top dollar for it. If they can have that in their own school on a Friday, and then that next week they can go and take part in whatever sport they enjoy. I think that's really important, that we're making sure the activities in the local area are sustainable through utilising the local clubs that are willing to take part. But it is very much a partnership approach, and I think that's how we get around the issues of ensuring that things are fun for people, but we're still meeting the objectives that we're looking to meet.
Bob Doris.
Thanks, convener. Really interesting discussions. I'm interested in teasing out where actually there's less going on, because David Smith gave a really powerful example of volunteers leading in Drumchapel, and I'm sure a variety of issues you raised in terms of cost and pressure on volunteers do need to be dealt with, convener, absolutely. I sat at a meeting in Royston in Glasgow as part of a regeneration of that local area, convener, where we're trying to map out where the sporting opportunities are within that local area. And there are a few, and it's mainly football. And there may be others, but there might just not be that many. So it's not specifically to Glasgow Life, because there's a variety of local authorities represented. I'm just wondering what mapping is done
for the various local authorities where there are black spots, if you like, where there are people who would thirst to be involved in a variety of sports, may not have had the opportunity, and how you do a bit of development work to take forward communities that maybe aren't at the stage that David Smith and you know the sports hub in Drumchapel are, despite obviously the barriers you need to overcome to develop further. But what kind of mapping exercise happens in the different local authorities to go, well, actually, in this part of the local authority, there's not that much going on. We know people are travelling out with their community to do sports. So in Royston, for example, they may go elsewhere. They may not go at all. But how do you tease some of that out, and how do you do the sports and physical activity development work to nurture some of that?
Andrew, from the local authority perspective.
Yeah. We're now moving into a second phase of funding for the community sports hubs, and one of the first schools we're working in now is Whipburn Academy. So that was actually highlighted through the council, meetings with senior managers. We were looking at, it's quite close to Armadale, so we were looking at putting a hub at the other side of the county. The senior managers and councillors are quite keen that we use the model we've got and try and make it work in an area that's a wee bit more challenging. So Armadale has been a challenge, but I think Whipburn's going to be a wee bit more of a challenge. It's as you kind of described there. There's a couple of sports clubs there, as mainly football, and actually some of the football teams or clubs, the teams within the clubs, have been moving out to other facilities in other parts of the county because the facilities in Whipburn haven't been accessible, or they haven't been at standard for the clubs to want to play there. So there's a wider regeneration package happening in Whipburn, and the community sports hubs is part of that. So the first stage for us to tackle is access to the facilities around the school estate. The school estate actually has, it's got a rugby pitch, it's got a 3G football pitch, it's got a 3 badminton court hall, sports hall, it's got a dance studio, it's got a swimming pool, but the access to it through the current PPP contract has been quite restrictive. So we're now using the sports hub to go in and challenge the contract and try and get the maximum out of that PPP contract that allows more access. So at the moment, we're not getting access to the weekends, and we're kind of in discussions to get that open. There's a 3G pitch sitting there that would allow the clubs to play football on the 3G pitch at the weekend, no matter what the weather, apart from maybe snow. So it's looking at that. We're still struggling to get access to the swimming pool, which would allow more club or more swimming club use within that town. So there's, we're using the sports hub to be able to open access to the facilities to allow the clubs to come in there. With regards to increasing numbers of clubs and developing the clubs, I mentioned before I've got a sports development officer now at Armadale that kind of works directly with the club. So they'll go and they meet with them face to face. They ask them what their needs are, what their development needs are, and they'll look at the clubs one club at a time, effectively, and then he will generate a plan of what coach education they need, what links to schools the clubs have. He would work with active schools coordinators to introduce better or more links with the schools that hopefully will drive participation. So with us putting the hubs into different areas, we're able to improve that a bit more and improve that kind of that contact with the clubs that we don't have at the moment, because we've only got 5 officers working across the county of 60-odd clubs. So we're using that to direct officer time to those clubs in those areas a wee bit more. So.
Yes, Graham. Yep. Graham.
Thank you. Just in response to that initial kind of mapping exercise that was carried out within North Lanarkshire, that was about establishing a working relationship with the Cultural Trust to operate our community access to facilities, and just having that picture in terms of reporting on what is currently provided within each of the sites that we use. All of our hubs are school sites. It's then really just a case of building it into a picture of broader knowledge, so looking at the active schools reports in terms of priority sports within the areas, in terms of where there's a large amount of participation that's not catered for by the community. Working in partnership with Scottish governing bodies of sport, looking at what are your priorities for development sport in North Lanarkshire, what support can we have, and really just kind of having that whole partnership approach as has been spoken about a number of times today, and then again tying in our sports specific development plans to our sports development officer. So it's the whole concept is sharing information and getting as many people around that table as possible so we can have that picture of where and when we need to develop sports within our hubs.
I suppose what
What was mm-hmm. Is there someone's wanting in there or not? But no. Okay.
That's all right,
is where there are clubs, you can capacity build, and you can help develop them. Where there are volunteers, you can capacity build, and you help develop them. What I suppose I was looking for was where there's a mapping exercise to see where there's maybe a lack of clubs or a lack of volunteers, and therefore a lack of provision. And what development work has done, I mean, in some respects, the low-hanging fruit to achieve success is identifying clubs who, with a little bit of assistance, could be spectacular, and that's a really good thing to do. But it's where perhaps there isn't the range of provision in clubs. So I'm interested to know about work in relation to that. But, and also, I suppose, maybe the sports trusts around the table, the local authorities around the table, where they have a centralised system for mapping out who's using the larger facilities within the local authority areas, maybe can work out who is using those facilities and who are not using those facilities, because understand people, some people travel out with their communities if they don't have facilities, others won't, and has mapping and planning been done in relation to that? I'm not trying to be awkward, I'm just thinking that this is a really obvious thing to do, mm-hmm. to plan getting those least likely to be physically active, or those who haven't volunteered yet, to work with them to start volunteering. And yes, it's important to bring forward and develop volunteers that already exist and clubs that already exist, but it's where there's a gap and what works going on around that.
If I just give one specific example,
yeah.
In terms of within our sports hub at St Margaret's, which is in Airdrie, there is no history or club infrastructure within the sport of netball. It's just not something that exists within that community. However, netball is one of the largest participation sports within the school environment in that area. So that is very much the circumstance where somebody would have to travel a number of miles to participate in that sport. The approach we've taken with that is, you know, going back to what Andrew's touched on earlier through our school-based volunteer. So looking, identifying our young leaders within schools. We established a coach development programme within that high school cluster for that Airdrie community, where we took young people from the age of 16 to the age of 24, put them through a range of generic coaching qualifications, upskilled them to give them the expertise to become those leaders within that community. And off the back of that, we've identified three new volunteers to establish a netball club in that community. And again, they're on that pathway now of going through sports-specific coaching qualifications. Where the community sport hub aspect comes into that is we're actually linking that to one of the stronger clubs within that hub, who are a football club, who are a legacy level quality mark club. So, you know, they're a 500 member football club looking to expand the provision that they offer within the community. So that's an example of the sports hub identifying a need and then taking a volunteer development approach and then tagging that into an existing club to give them that infrastructure and support so that these new volunteers that we've worked with aren't left with that sole burden of running that club. I hope that kind of answers off the first part of that question. Yeah.
Well, actually, that's a great example.
Yeah. Dan wants to come in there.
Yeah.
Just a really interesting point made by Bob, and I think it was one of the biggest aspects of getting the community sport hubs off the ground in Highland was that mapping process. So it was a really exciting project in terms of starting with a blank canvas and saying, well, actually, let's go to Tain, a local community, and see what's out there. And by getting, you know, the people that are not necessarily captured in the ASMO staff that come through active schools. There's lots of groups out there that say, well, we're not a sports club, we're just a group of guys that play badminton on a Tuesday night, or we're just a group of guys and girls that go running on a Tuesday. They're not necessarily captured anywhere. But I think the community sport hub has been the vehicle to capture these groups of people and identify that where the gaps are. And just sort of as Graham touched upon, by having the schools round the table, by having the schools round the table, we managed to identify, well, there's a lot of, you know, Graham's example, netball going on in school and after school, but there's no club provision. Can we make that happen? Is there an opportunity to make that happen or not? So I think just in terms of the Community Sport Hub project, that mapping process initially was absolutely vital to where we went with it.
Anyone else? Andrew,
again,
I'll put you in the net.
within the early stages of the Whippern model getting kind of developed, we've done the forum, the club forum there at the moment. Again, as I alluded to that earlier, there's councillors involved in that. In Whippern, there's also a Whippern Community Trust that looks at, you know, the town as a whole and what things can benefit the people of Whippern. And there's also a sports club there called Whippern Sports Club that. Is at the moment it's a coalition of kind of football clubs, but they're looking to expand to support other sports that are going on, so or different sports as well. So they're all around the table. As well as that, there's youth leaders within the school as well. So at the last sports forum there for the Whippern Community Sports Hub, the youth leader actually presented findings of a questionnaire that they did within the school to ask the people in the school what sports they take part in, where do they take part in the sports, you know, are you leaving Whippern, are you doing it here in Whippern, and you know, so we've got a good bit of information from S1 to S4s within Whippern Academy about their aspirations of, you know, people that are taking part in sport, why are they taking part, those who aren't, why are they not, and those who are, where are you doing it? Are you doing it locally? Are you doing it further afield and whatnot? So we have done that mapping exercise and we'll continue to do it. It's vital to do that, or else you're not going to, you know, hit any targets. You're not going to support local communities. So.
Okay. Colin Keir, then Richard Lyle. Oh, well, no, I've been in there because she has.
Convener, I'm happy to hear that things are moving along quite nicely with in terms of clubs and the likes with the sports hubs. One of the questions I have, though, and I don't think, I think it may have been touched on by a couple, though, is particularly those that are PPP school projects and the likes, but might come into other areas as well. But we've been dealing an awful lot with hubs dealing with clubs, but what about the people who just want to be able to walk in and use a facility such as a swimming pool or something like that? What's being done for them, the people in the community who really, you know, somebody like myself who probably could lose a few pounds and whatever, but can't get into his local hub just to go for a swim? So maybe what kind of work's being done on that to create space and availability for these people?
Paul. So I think this can be a bit of a problem for sports when it gets, or physical activity when it gets mixed up with sports clubs and participation and things. And you know, one of the things that we've found we've had to do at Inch Park is think very differently about how we engage young people in particular that don't have an interest in sport. And it's sort of to you from a different angle. It's to the same point, which is actually they don't want to go along to an organised session where there's 30 other people that they think are going to be better than them and be sure, you know, there's how do you engage somebody who has such a negative perception of sport and physical activity and probably themselves as well in something and help them share in the community asset. So. And actually those sorts of people aren't going to just walk in either, even if you gave them that opportunity. So we've had to think quite differently about how we structure programmes.
How do you quantify that? Because there are people, middle-aged people, it's not just kids.
Yeah.
Middle-aged people. How do you quantify that? Because that's a bit of a sweeping statement, because people come into sport at different times for different reasons.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure at this moment in time I would wholeheartedly agree with what you just said.
Which aspect, sorry, about the...
About the sweeping statement, you're not going to get them in anyway. That was what you just said, you know, because of the negative attitude. It's not a negative attitude.
No.
It's people who want to go in.
Yeah.
Okay, it's another struggle to get people who are not interested in going in. But for those people who do want to get in but can't get the time and the space but don't want to become members of clubs.
Sure, I was giving a specific example about a group of young people that sits to the same point. I'm not saying for a minute that there are not people in the circumstance you describe. However, I don't have an example of that for you. So to be able to answer your question about, you know, access for people in different areas, I can talk from experience of that specific group. And that specific group that we work with are the young people that are in the situation we describe. Now, the reason I make that point is the answer is still the same, which is rather than having a traditional membership model on a Tuesday night where people come along to a structured space. You have to create opportunities that meet the needs of those young people, or not young people if you're talking about different groups. And what we've had to do in that aspect is actually target people in the area that aren't getting, through the schools and our links, that aren't getting access to physical activity, and look at activities where we can bring them together in an environment and introduce them to physical activity. So I think the short answer to that in terms of an example is I think the traditional sports model will cater for, the people that show an interest in sports. There also needs to be some recognition when we're looking at the work to do in communities around how you engage people that aren't engaged in sport and physical activity and activities around that. And that has to be factored into to access and programs and what you build, rather than just having the traditional sports structures. What I don't have is any example, because of the way we're structured, of that specific group that you're talking about. Nor would I say that it doesn't exist. It's just not something that we particularly cater for at the moment.
David, and then Andrew.
I'm wanting to highlight the fact that for the people sitting around this table who have got a keen interest in sport, it may come as a surprise for some of us to hear that there are people out there, no matter what creative ideas and methods and initiatives we come up with, there will be people out there who don't have an interest in getting involved in any sport. So I think that's a fact that we do have to accept. However, having said that, it doesn't mean that we can't try to be creative, we can't try to come up with initiatives, we can't try to reinvent the wheel. If somebody did something 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 20 years ago that worked well, can we not replicate that? And I think an answer to your question, maybe something I've already highlighted, but just to kind of emphasise again, is that in Drumchapel we've got a fantastic track record of putting on events over the lifespan of our community, which Fiona already highlighted is 60 years, where people can come along and try things and see if they like it. Now, if people like it and want to get involved and play to the competitive level, they're directed towards that club. So, for example, the D60 event, which takes place in a big open field in Drumchapel, all the sports are there, Glasgow Life are there, all the different initiatives. If people want to play to the competitive level and they want to play football, they're directed towards a local football club. If they want to play to the competitive level and it's netball, volleyball, hockey, whatever the sport is, they're directed towards the club because they all buy into it and they all want to participate. If people are wanting to take casual bookings or play for fun or get advice about when they want to drop in and play a particular sport, they can be directed towards that club as well, but they can also be directed towards the facilities that are in our community. So if someone wants to play casual tennis, they're directed towards the local leisure centre. If someone wants to casually book another sport, they're directed towards any of the other facilities where that can take place. So
I really am trying to get at the person who's just decided to do something out with. He just wants to, in my case, walk 5 minutes up the road to a sports hub, jump in a swimming pool for half an hour and swim twice a week, something like that. Doesn't want to get involved. He's made up his mind, he wants to lose a bit of weight. He just wants to go through it and do that. Doesn't want to get directed to clubs, and he doesn't want to get patched into that that system. He just wants to do it himself. Now, there's the example. And when you walk up to my local facility, you can't use the pool, despite the fact that it's empty. What I'm trying to say is, what sort of stuff? How can you change the pattern? I know it's difficult when you're doing block bookings for clubs and various initiatives, which are all really welcome. I'm not saying it's an easy ask, but what is actually being done in terms of just letting somebody get on with what they want to do? Because it seems to be that one of the things, and it was actually talking to a neighbour of mine who's going through this, one of the things that puts him off is he doesn't want to get involved, he just wants to go and do his own thing. Really should be me, I have to say.
Yeah, I think just to make a point about the Drumchapel Sports Hub, it's not a facility-based model or a school-based model, it's just an area-based model where the clubs within that community come together. So to take your example in question, if in Drumchapel you did want to go for a run in the gym or to the swimming pool for a swim, the community sports hub don't have any ownership of those lets whatsoever. The individual clubs just book what they require. So if you did walk up there, there should be a timetable that allows you to swim in a public open time out with the community sports hub, where you wouldn't be directed towards any particular club. You could just swim as an individual.
I think Colin's identified an area as well, and we focused on clubs and, you know, whether it be a club that sometimes is developed out of an illness or a stroke or a heart attack. Well, we tend to group people together when life simply isn't like that. People pursue an individual, and the pay and play model, is something that people can enjoy and do enjoy. And again, it may be back to what David's thinking about, but these assets and having access, not just in cost barriers, but to, you know, there's a whole lot of issues that are barriers we might want to look at. But we've got 7 minutes, I think, in this session, and I've got Richard Lyle to get in again, but I've got Nanette Millen, who hasn't asked the question, and I'm going to let Nanette in, get quick responses, and then you're going to finish up with a quick question and quick responses. Thanks, Richard. Nanette.
Thank you, Convener. I mean, it really is, I suppose, a sort of almost a follow-on from Colin Keir's thing. And it's the almost how inclusive community sports clubs are across the generations, if you like, in a community. I mean, involving the sort of grannies like me and the mums and the dads and the kids and all the rest of it. I mean, is there an effort to really be inclusive to all generations? You know, thinking in terms of how important it is to be active and ideally contribute to sport throughout one's life. Any thoughts or comments?
Yeah, what do your strategies tell us about that wider involvement? Where is the... Anyone want to pick up on that? Andrew?
Yep.
Good.
Again, with our work in Armadale, it's based within a school site, but it's the sports hub is across the town. The officer working in there at the moment, he supports the clubs and the facility at Armadale Academy. But he works very closely with Wesleyan Leisure, who have a leisure pool and a fitness gym there in Armadale as well, right in the centre of the town. But they also support the facilities of the local bowling club as well. It's looking at what sports provision is there across the town and in what ways can we support them. So the bowling club, for example, the majority of the support comes with actually supporting them with the facilities. So, you know, if the heater pack's in, who do they go to within the council to support them getting their heater fixed and things like that as well. But it's also, we're working with them to get to understand that, you know, they have an aging population within their club. And getting them to understand that there'll be benefits to linking with the schools. They've got a good volunteer base because the majority of their members are retired now, and they do maybe have a bit of extra time on their hands to work within the schools. So we do very much look across the age kind of spectrum, and we do understand that club sport isn't for everybody, but it is the majority of the work that the sports hubs for us are there to work with, and again, that's kind of directive from Sports Scotland is, you know, the sports clubs are there to develop clubs, so all the stuff that we do around about it is the stuff that we as local authority want to achieve, as well as all the stuff from Sports Scotland. So
okay. I've got Graham and David, and sorry to restrict you, but we're into our last five. Graham,
just to come back to your point there, Nanette. I think it comes back to clubs understanding what their role is within the community and not being there just to serve one specific group of people. I don't have a specific example of a piece of work that's been done, but more of an assurance that within the Creston Community Sport Hub, what we're doing there is we're linking with the community forum, which has representation from community council, uniformed organisations, as well as senior citizens groups. So it's about building that understanding within those clubs that they fit into a broader picture, and we're looking to start to create links between those representatives from those groups to ensure that what is offered within the hub does cater for the full community. So just a bit of work that's happening there.
Thanks, Graham. David?
I was just going to say that it takes a number of different factors to build a club, to get them to the level where they can look to start creating provision for different areas. I'm quite fortunate at the club that I coach at that we're well developed and we've got a pretty resolute committee, and the fact that recently we've just created an over 35s football team, and now we're looking at a 50 plus football team. But the issue that we're coming across at the moment is that maybe some of the other clubs locally are not at that stage where they can cater for that. So you're coming up with all these great ideas to enhance, to develop, to grow, to get better, to increase participation, to do all the things that you want to do. But then when you go out and you start to speak to people about it, for one reason or another, the other football clubs or the other organisations in your area or out with your area are not quite at that level. So you stimulate an interest in your community, you get people active, you get people involved, you get people infused, you get people ready to participate, and then you're like, who are we going to play against? Okay, right, we'll leave that to another day. So that's a kind of a wee issue as well.
Anyone else? We've got our final question then from Richard Lyer.
David, all the points you've made today, the music to my ears. Previously a councillor in North Lancashire had an area which had an area of deprivation, and the points about costs, etc. I mean, I'm sure you and Fiona will sit down and work it all out. The pricing, the basically schools, new schools were built. I was on the council when we built new schools in North Lancashire. The situation of going, the gates are shut, but we've got all these 3G pitches. But really a question I want to ask, we haven't covered, and just quick answers, guys. We're concerned about kids being obese, diabetes, all the different things, all the great work you guys are doing, all the great street work you're doing, nighttime, football, etc., blah, blah, blah. But how do we get parents to get their kids out of their bedrooms, away from their iPads, their computers, and their game consoles? Just quickly.
Tough one. I think it's about culture building, and it's about trying to change the culture that we currently have, and trying to get people, not just out the kids out of the bedrooms, just getting people out the house and getting them to enjoy the local space, not just at the sports hubs, but there's local parks, and there's we need to get people just out of their house and being more active, and that activity could be cycling, it could be walking down the path, it could be anything. So it's about an overall culture change. I think we are, hopefully most of the guys will agree with me around the table, that we do, that is one of the biggest challenges within sport, is you can enthuse that one child as much as you want, but if they go home and their mum and dad go, no, I'm not leaving on Wednesday, that's when Coronation Street's on, they're never going to get to that sports club. So it is about, it's about changing that culture and about helping families or mums and dads make those decisions and with more information and make better choices.
The final whistle here. Yep. Dave's got about 5 seconds, I think.
Right, quickly, I was just, trust, it takes time. How do we get the parents and these people involved? How do we create opportunities for them to get involved? Can we reward clubs who participate actively in going through accreditation schemes? So how do we reward clubs who become organised, who become quality marked, who adhere to their national governing bodies, stringent standards, who participate in the local authorities' standards? And then, how do we get these parents involved? Can we create an opportunity for them? Is it just about their child coming along and participating, or is there something we can hook them in with as well? And then obviously rewarding and taking that time, because it takes time to build the trust, it takes time to engage with people, it takes time to create all these opportunities, make them sustainable, all the points that have been raised today. But how do we do it? That's for me is the pertinent question.
We've had another. I'm sorry to cut people off, but we've reached that point. We've had another interesting, wide-ranging discussion about the games and its legacy, whether we should be measuring the inputs or the outputs. We haven't even spoken about sport literacy or physical education in our schools and all of that. But we will, as a committee, I hope, gather some of this and have some discussions, and I hope that we can maybe focus in on a couple of areas in the last year of the committee that we can actually focus in on and get some action on, because the area is so wide. And if we can focus in on some of those most important areas to yourselves or to the wider communities that we represent, then that would be the challenge for us. But thank you all for your time this morning and your written evidence. I hope that I'm sure the committee will be able to use some of that evidence in their further discussions and their further work programme. Thank you all very much indeed. Thank you for your attendance this morning. Thank you. We're going to have to push on now, so the usual sort of chat after the meeting if I can get item 7 agreed with quickly, we might actually be able to speak to some of the participants here. We now move to agenda item number 7, which is our first approach to the petition P01453, Richard, which has been referred to us by the Public Petitions Committee. The petition, as you know from your papers, is from Caroline Wilson, and it calls on Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce an opt-out system of organ donation in Scotland to help save more lives. You will have seen the paper, of course, and which recommends that we defer further consideration to this petition until the introduction of the proposed Members' Bill on this subject. Now, I think that's entirely sensible, but obviously we need the support of the committee to do that and agree that we would defer our discussion on this subject, and with the full knowledge, of course, that we would be able to return to the petition at a point in the future. Rhoda.
Do we know when that's likely to be?
We don't have a definite indication as yet, but it's in progress. Mm-hmm.
Bob, and then Richard.
Yeah, just wondering, obviously, for the petitioner, given some kind of details of potential timescale, as Rhoda suggested, would be helpful. So rather than kind of assisting it indefinitely, do we put a timescale of when this comes back to our committee again to decide whether or not we take it forward? Or do we just say until we get more information?
Until more information or further consideration in 3 months, if that would be a condition you would think would be valuable.
It just allows it not to be open-ended, and it allows us to update the petitioner in relation to that.
Well, that would be, are we deferring it and asking for the additional information? And then, if that information gives us cause for thought, then we could consider it again. Yeah. Okay, is that okay, Richard?
Yeah, convener, I quite agree with you. You know, if you remember, this is quite a massive campaign by the Even Times. I think most of us signed up to it at the time. And basically, I think we have to certainly ensure that this is kept in the forefront of the agenda.
Yeah, I think we all agree. No further comment. We're deferring until and requesting some information on the timeline. Are we agreed on that?
Great.
Thank you all very much for your attendance, participation and patience this morning. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good.